So today we have a very good speaker, well, Esther Duflo, an American, French, Indian economist, and very well known. She's a last year Nobel Prize winner. So Esther, thank you very much for agreeing to talk to us. Everybody characterizes you as a very pragmatist economist. So she's a pragmatic who does things which are very practical. And she says, therefore, that economists should be plumbers rather than just visionary or engineers. So Esther, could you please elaborate a little bit more about this concept? Does it apply to, if not monetary policy, then banking and financial sector regulation and supervision? What do you think?
Yeah, so I think what I've argued is a little less big than that. I've not argued that all economists should be plumbers, but that there is space for plumbing. There is also space for theory and big ideas, and there is place for engineering, which is, you know, if you want the simulation, computational work, etc. And what I mean by plumbing is really engage into the minutiae of the policy work and policy implementation, which we have much less guidance about. And with the plumbing, we are going in the real world and we are just trying things out in a world that we know is much more complicated than what we can comprehend. The same way that a plumber will try and fix a leak somewhere, and if it doesn't work, they'll try something else because they don't have the whole vision of the system. And my argument is that policy work is often like that, to a large extent, that policymakers often are not so interested in that aspect of things, and that economists are very rarely interested in that aspect of things. So in a sense, nobody is interested. And therefore, you can have ideas that are great, and engineers that put in place some, you know, great systems, but then at the last, you know, in the last step of implementation, it fails. So my work is mostly on development, but I think that insight applies very much to all policy work.
Let's go to your research agenda. How did COVID-19 change that?
In the short run, I think like many economists, I got consumed by the desire to do something on COVID-19. And this is amazing, how everybody shifted on a dime and started doing COVID-19 related research. A lot of my work has been on preventive health and on social networks and how social network can be harnessed to encourage preventive health behavior. Quite naturally, my instinct was to pivot towards those type of project, which I've done both in India and in the US. And I also happen to have to be engaged in a panel of old people in the south of India. And older poor people seem to be like the most affected by COVID-19 you can think of. So we started serving them and finding out how they're coping with the crisis and how government helps them cope with the crisis. In the medium run, my business model very much relies on being close to the people. And if you can't go out in the field at all, that's a little bit of an issue. So, again, in the very short run, it's not so much of a problem because anything that's already ongoing, we basically shifted to talking to people on the phone. But for future projects, it will be quite interesting how things are going to rearrange.
I see. I actually am quite sympathetic to what you're saying because we have this regular inflation expectation survey. And we had to change it dramatically because we were not able to make it person to person for a few months. We are now back to the old technologies because there is many of the restrictions have been beaconed in Russia, so we can do them in the older way. But for a few months, we had to do them by phone, and we had to change methodology. And basically, this few months information is not comparable to what we have done before. A more general question about COVID-19. We all noticed lack of trust in the economists in the last maybe 10, 15 years. Do you think COVID-19 is going to improve the situation or make it worse?
I think it's going to leave it in the same place for economists, because although we should be very pertinent, it should be very pertinent. I don't think people perceive us as being pertinent. I think now people perceive that we should, you know, hear from epidemiologists and from doctors, and the only thing people can think about is the vaccine. I think what's more interesting is what's going to happen to the governments. Not only, of course, there is mistrust of economists, but there is also a mistrust of government that is going and going and going over the last few years. And what you saw with COVID-19 is suddenly, boy, do we need the government. You know, there cannot be a mask mandate without the government. There cannot be ventilators in hospital without the government. There cannot be an economic rescue package without the government. So on the one hand, we realize, oh, actually, that's why we have a government. In some cases, we do need, you know, in some cases, the market is not going to solve all of the problems that we have. So then I think there is kind of a crossroad, which is either the government is successful, and then that's going to kind of maybe renew the trust that was dithering away. So you see Korea, where the trust in government was going down. I can totally imagine that it's going to go up, because like they've done such a good job. And on the other hand, you have countries where, you know, the US, where the government, trust in government was falling and falling and falling. And now the government is doing like a horrendous job of dealing with the pandemic.
I see. What about social society? Civil society.
So I don't know if there is such thing as trust in civil society, but at least during the lockdown in Italy, in France, in New York, people kind of got together a little bit. It seems to me there was a bit of a sense of commonality of purpose that's not there usually. Now, whether that's going to persist, I don't know. I hope it does, because we have a lot of common purposes in societies. We have a lot of challenges that need to be addressed by collective action. And if we can keep some of this spirit to solve bigger problems like climate change, for example, that would be a good thing.
Let's switch to communications. You know, central banks in the last maybe 20 years changed the paradigm significantly. I think that Greenspan used to say that being clear is not good for monetary policy. But now we communicate a lot. So do you have any advice for us, for monetary and finance, which comes from your research?
You know, communication by central bank is not so different than communication by another business. You want to think about it as marketing. And you need to try things out. So for example, see if people respond to inflation targeting with their own views on inflation, see whether consumer confidence respond to various kind of announcements. In a few years, but very few, I think 2-3 years, we'll start to have much more clarity on what people respond to in terms of the announcement, and therefore what announcement matter. The one thing that is that I think we found, which might be relevant, is that people respond, even when there are a lot of messaging around, people still respond to a credible voice. Mm-hmm. So we did this paper where Abhijit Banerjee was our credible voice, and we send those messages to COVID-19 messages to millions of people in West Bengal. And this is an environment where they heard, you know, several messages a day telling them what to do. And despite that, getting this one message changed their behavior and changed their willingness to report symptoms to the local health worker. This very much fits in all literature in psychology and marketing, that credible people make a difference.
Okay, that's very interesting. Let's speak about finance more generally. there's this old question whether finance is good for development or not, and what can we do as economists to sort of improve the effect of finance on development?
The COVID, in the COVID-19 crisis, the rich countries were able to borrow tons of money at almost zero interest rate, with no impact, obviously, on their credit rating. But the poor countries couldn't really do that, because if they had done that, they would have damaged their credit rating. I think that's an example of the problem with finance, the way that the financial world is approaching poor countries. It is pretty clear that now, you know, the need for borrowing in a country like, I don't know, Togo, is not related to some mismanagement on their part. It's related to a worldwide pandemic. So there is no moral hazard. And yet they cannot borrow.
Yeah, but it's also an issue of international financial architecture, right? This is why the IMF is trying to work quite heavily. But let's speak about micro problems in finance. Microfinance was very popular as an idea because it was believed that it will help entrepreneurs to develop. But now many countries, like Russia, for example, face the problems that microcredit usually provide very expensive credits for consumption purposes. So it's not clear whether it's good or actually bad for welfare. So is this a problem of design or the problem with the idea?
Over the years, we managed to do a number of evaluation of microcredit programs in many countries, going from Bosnia, Herzegovina, and Mongolia to Ethiopia and India. And in all of these countries, what we find is very much what you describe, which is microcredit typically is used for consumption purpose. It therefore does not lead to any expansion in businesses. And therefore, it doesn't help people get out of poverty. What it does is that it helps them buy, you know, something that they couldn't have, like a fridge or a cycle. So that doesn't mean that it's useless. I think it has some value. Maybe if your idea is to help people finance consumption, there are other products that are better appropriate to do that, for example, saving products. And if your objective is to help the people who really feel, who really want to be entrepreneurs, then there are probably also better products to do that.
I see. So it should be more tailored products to entrepreneurs. No,
I think much more, you know, the idea is that every poor person is an entrepreneur. And it's just not true. Like most poor people, like most not so poor people, are not entrepreneurs. They would rather have a rich job and peace of mind. In fact, some effort in identifying who wants to be an entrepreneur really pays off, because once you can find those people, they actually have huge returns to their business. It's just that it's a very small minority of the borrowers, and most of the borrowers borrow for consumption purposes.
Well, thank you very much, Esther. I think the time is up more or less for our talk. And I remember the last time we saw, you just opened your laboratory. That was a long time ago. When I met you, when I went to MIT. And right now it's really a movement. So I think that it's very important that such a passionate people like you, they manage to actually realize their passion and create a movement around that. This is what's changing the society in any case. Because when I prepared for this interview, I read a lot about what you have done over the last 20 years, and it's quite impressive. So let me congratulate you on that, and let me thank you once again for this conversation. When I read what you've been doing, I just started to get ideas that we probably need to think about what we do, following your examples, because there are many questions in regulation, like how do you set up pension system, right? Nobody actually used the approach which you have to these kind of questions.
Thank you so much, and thank you, and congratulations to you for your own excellent work.
Thank you very much. Good thank luck you so with much. Your job. Good luck Hello. With your movement, and thanks again for this talk. Thank you.